cracking the book on our textbook. We are using Writing in College from Competence to Excellence by Amy Guptil from SUNY, New York. I would like to point out right off the bat, this is relevant. This is Creative Commons, non-commercial, share and share alike. Anyone is allowed to share, copy, redistribute, adapt. As the only thing is, you have to give attribution. You have to say it came from Amy Guptil and SUNY. You also have to give it away for free. Now, there's a reason I'm doing this. This is a big part of my sabbatical. I have decided that I would, many teachers write books and they make a little bit of money off of it. The college often makes even more money than the teacher. And, well, most money goes to the publisher. Books, you may not realize this, but in my lifetime, the cost of books has skyrocketed. Much of the cost of education has moved from the state and federal level to students. We're just pushing costs on you that used to be covered other places. And for my sabbatical proposal, I want to go gather images, data, examples that can supplement this. Sometimes, generally, OER textbooks are a little bland because they don't have pictures, because you have to pay for those. But I have the advantage of a close relationship with a professional photographer who's really good. And I'm going to be traveling to gather. Now, the reason for OER and what it means is that you don't have to pay for it. And there's a couple of real reasons this is important. Research has shown that, students aren't buying the books when they're too expensive. They're quite often not taking classes because the books are too expensive. A book that's unread is a useless book. 20% of students have skipped or blown off a class, deferred taking it, because of the cost of learning materials, and these costs are going up. If everybody who taught Comp 1 were to adapt the book I'm using, or the book, and I'm going to adapt it, I'm going to add content to it, I'm probably going to add a chapter on memoirs or narrative writing. Doesn't touch on narratives, it focuses on argument, which is kind of a traditional way to approach Comp 1, but I think that narratives provide a very accessible way to discuss composition, and narrative drives everything from marketing to law. It's all about the story. So I think we traditional scholars tend to overlook or de-emphasize narrative, and I think that's a mistake. Anyway, you can check out my blog. Back to our book. The thing is, I'm doing this free. It's part of a movement. It's trying to make things more accessible. I'm at Johnson County Community College because I wanted to teach at a community college. I believe in the democratic aspect of community colleges. Anybody can go to community college. And I think that's good. I'm not a big fan of the whole ivory tower thing. Always look at your table of contents when you get a book. We're going to cover chapter one today. I do encourage you in the first 8 weeks to, as soon as possible, at your earliest convenience, read chapters 1, 2, 4, and 5. Don't always assign and check and test whether you read things, but these are short chapters. They're well written. They're clear. They're written in normal language, not for academics. And it's telling you stuff that, I mean, the reason I chose this book out of many that were looked up, and I had, by the way, I should mention, give a shout out to Barry Bailey, who helped me find this and helped me find most of the books I found. And it has been essential in this idea that we can provide books for free, because really I can teach a class without having to make you buy a $150 book. These are short chapters, and you are expected to do homework. You're supposed to read stuff even if I don't tell you. All right, chapter one. Writing? Again? Yes, again. The reason I chose this book is because of all the books I looked at, I found myself saying, yes, yes, this is common sense. One of the reasons I don't do a good job teaching from the book is because I know everything in it, and it seems like common sense to me, and I don't get really excited about it. But you should. You should check this out. You should read this. Boom, number one, research shows deliberate practice. Yes, we're going to do a lot of writing this semester. And what I find from working with people in educational technology and other departments is that people think Comp 1 teachers give a lot of homework. And that is absolutely true, because only by assigning things, checking things, making sure people turn things in, only by requiring people to practice daily, only then, by focusing on deliberate practice, can we improve our writing. Comp 1 is work. Traditionally, we used to call it a gatekeeper class, because comp teachers, their job was to keep people who were unworthy of college out And it's true. If most people who don't finish college do it because they didn't finish either Comp 1 or Comp 2 or College Algebra. These are the gatekeeper or gateway classes. I see it more as a gateway. If you can make it through my class, and I will walk you through. If you, in good faith, come to class every day and try, I can help you develop the skills to succeed in college. If I highlighted something, I want you to read it. So you can hit pause here if that helps. Take some time and read this stuff. Employers, business people, you know, business. The thing they say they need that they don't get from their workers, from their clients, is the ability to communicate in writing. And it's not just dictating what someone else tells you. Comp 1 is about critical thinking. And that's why my personal philosophy, my educational andragogy, I hate the word pedagogy, my andragogy is inquiry-based learning. The student has to drive this. I am very much student-centered, but as I will talk later, student-centered doesn't mean what most people say it means. Student-centered doesn't mean we're Burger King and the customer's always right. Student-centered means the onus, the burden, the weight, the center of gravity of the class is pushed toward the students. Students have to do the work, because people who do the work get the benefit. Now, think about it this way. If you're New Year's and everyone's starting their New Year's resolution, people are joining gyms. Now, if someone told you they joined a new gym and they got a personal trainer and he was a real jerk and they didn't like him and they didn't do anything the trainer said and they didn't get stronger and they didn't lose any weight, it's the trainer's fault. Would you believe that? Or do you think that if you want to lose weight and get in better shape, you have to follow the instructions or the ideas, you have to listen to your trainer, and then you have to put in the work? You have to get on the Stairmaster. You have to jog. You have to lift weights. Nobody else can do that for you. Well, yeah, we all understand that, right? Why is it we think professors can somehow magically pour smarts into your brain in a passive sort of, I'll pick it up automatically? No. College is work. You're expected to put in a couple hours outside of class for every hour you're in it. What that means is, I told you should have the chapters 1, 2, 4, and 5 read the first 8 weeks. Well, as soon as you can. If you don't have anything else to do, you schedule a couple hours a night, every night, or 3 nights a week, however you want to figure it. But for my class alone, you should have 6 hours a week. You don't know what else to do? Is it clear what I've assigned yet? Read the book. Your homework is to read the book. Is it read? No, then you got that to do, all right? There's always something you can do to make yourself more prepared and better. Don't wait for the teacher to tell you to do your reading. It's like exercising. If you're waiting for your coach or your trainer to give you explicit instructions before you get up and go jogging, you're not going to have the success that someone who's self-motivated is going to have. Winners don't wait to be told what to do. Now, one thing I do like about this book is that it kind of, if you're like me, I was kind of first generation college. Actually, my parents met in college, but neither of them finished. I kind of complicated things for them when I was born. College was a different sort of environment. I did not know what to expect when I first went to school. And I think a great deal of my students at JCC are the same. It may seem and feel like high school right here, but it's not. There's some fundamental differences that I've touched on in other material I've provided for you, and the book explains it here on page 2, The Origins of Higher Education. It is not the same. It's fundamentally different. It's subtle, but it's a powerful difference. And student-centered, even a lot of my colleagues don't understand, student-centered doesn't mean the student's always right. Students have to be the master of their own destiny. They have to be the one making decisions. They have to be the ones doing the work. I can't learn for you. Professors are scholars and artists. That's true. Pretty much all of them are. Now, it says here most of your professors have little to no formal training in, it should say andragogy, it says pedagogy. By the way, pedagogy comes from the Latin ped, the same word that gives us pedophile. Ped means child. Pedophiles love children in a creepy way. Pedagogy is the science of learning, leading children. Andragogy is more accurate, which is adult. I'm dealing with adults. Whether you know it or are ready for it, you are adults in my class. Anything I've highlighted, make sure you understand. I would like you to read all of it, but make sure you focus on the stuff that's underlined. I like this part here about professors having competing obligations. We're writing books. We are making films, working with multimedia. So we have outside things. A lot of my time is also dealt with committee work. And way too much of my time is dealing with unnecessary things about teaching that you don't think of when you think of teaching, like discipline. Like, if I got a student sexually or in any other way harassing another student, I got to get everything lined up. I need to deal with the behavior. I need to document the behavior. I need to protect the college from lawsuits. I need to protect the student who's the victim. And I need to educate and hopefully rehabilitate, I guess, the person who's causing the problem. Or if it's a dynamic that's not just one but two, it's complicated. There's a lot of stuff that takes time. We're always busy. My dad used to think since I taught 15 hours a week, I only worked 15 hours a week, which is ridiculous. No, it's like saying that Bill Self for the KU basketball team only plays like 30 basketball games and they're 2 hours a pop, so he only works 60 hours a year and he makes millions of dollars. Now there's a lot more involved. There's practice, there's recruiting. And I spend way over my 40. I have 4 class preps. I teach 4 different classes this semester. Keep that in mind. I don't live in the classroom, by the way. I have an office. A lot of people seem to think that I should be in the classroom all the time. That's not how it works in college. We move from classroom to classroom, teach a class, and then we leave. This little instruction about what assistant professor and associate professor is important. I didn't figure that out till I was a professor, actually. I am still associate professor, but next year I'll be full professor. But sometimes, unofficially, we call that silverbacks. That'll be cool. Oh, I want to point out number 8 right here. Some instructors are very persnickety about being addressed as doctor or professor. And people sometimes get me wrong when I'm trying to explain that to them. So the book, I like that the book actually mentions this. I've had professors, when I was a student, get quite upset if you call them Miss or Mrs. Because it's a professional title. We're in a professional setting. That's the way it works. I've noticed that women and people of color, people have had to overcome more oppression or baloney coming up through their career. They like that title. Also, when the students may be of a group or social clique that is in power and the professor is not, it does a little respect can go a long way. And you can accidentally sometimes step on toes without being aware of it. So call everybody professor, all right? Unless you know they're a doctor and you think they like it, you can call them doctor, whatever. Don't call them, hey, doctor. That sounds weird. But if you want to call me Dr. Dixon, that's fine. But I'm totally cool with professor. But don't call me mister. Don't call me Ms. Don't call me by my first name, because only salesmen, and once you got me in that head space, I think you're trying to sell me something. No, salesmen hate me. Again, I touched on this earlier. Students drive their own learning. The assumption behind high school instruction is that the teacher is the engine of learning. Consequently, a lot of time is spent in face-to-face direct instruction. Homework reinforces. The teachers will often tell students what each night's homework assignment is, following up on missing work, and closely tracking student progress. The assumption behind college instruction, in contrast, is that students are the engine of learning. That most of the significant learning happens outside of class while students are working through dense reading or other challenging intellectual tasks of their own. Most college classes only meet 1 or 3 times a week, for us 3, for a total of about 3 hours. Consequently, college instructors think of class meetings as an opportunity to prepare you for the heavy lifting. I like to do active learning, things that involve and require and benefit from interaction where we can learn from each other. I am a facilitator and very much into active learning. I lay out a path, and if you watch that video with Bender, I recommend it somewhere else. Yeah, even before I read this book, that was my model. That's how I thought it. I thought I came up with that idea alone and individually, but somehow it's not an uncommon idea. Or I just like Dr. Guptil, Professor Guptil, and I seem to be on the same page. Not everybody did. I'll work with you. Talk to me. Don't try and hide any sort of shortcoming when it comes to reading or writing. I will work with you. I'm cool. And I actually have a PhD in education, so I've got training and research in how to help people with ADD, ADHD, dyslexia, and anything else. Well, let me know. I'm good at research, so if you have an issue, I'll help you find solutions. I'll help find reading that'll help you. If you don't read, I will help you find different ways to read. As an audio book. I do, whether you realize it or not, I think of you as an independent scholar, a junior scholar, and imagine you as someone who has a genuine, driving interest in tackling some complex question. I envision you approaching the assignment without a thesis. I see you as people wanting to learn open to knowledge, not trying to bend facts to fit some preconceived argument that you were given by an elder or some idiot on TV. I want you to look at evidence. I want you to change your mind when the evidence warrants changing your mind. I want you to consider alternative explanations. And I want you to figure out an original, insightful argument that you actually care about. This scholarly approach, key point right here, writing a paper isn't about getting the right answer. No, it's about figuring out what you have to say, figuring out what you think. However, with Professor Guptil, my experience shows me that few students actually approach writing the way I think they would approach writing. Many students seem to first figure out what they want to say, and then and only then write it down clearly and as quickly as they can. A quick round of proofreading, and they're done. If they have to do research, they just go and do a Google search. They cherry-pick a quote that generally is out of context and doesn't really support their argument. Just shove it in there. And they go, that's good enough. And yeah, notice that frowny face and the erg. Not a good idea. And this is why we sometimes have to repeat classes. Oh, I love this. The term for this art, coined by novelist and memoirist Anne Lamott, is shitty first drafts. English teachers have colorful language. Professors find that tendency frustrating. Some instructors craft an assignment sequence to force a true revising process. That's what I do that. And some people hate that, you know, because it's more work, but it's a much better product you produce. I like this line here. You're writing to learn, you're writing to develop, you're writing to think, not just to express. If I wanted uninformed opinions, I would watch cable TV. I don't care what people who don't think are thinking. I want to know what people who care, people who have done research, people who have taken things seriously. I want to know what they think. I want to know why, and I need support. I need to know. You have to cite your sources. Look, it's like she stole this from my video, and my video predates this book. I myself, as a student, even as a doctoral student, was quite frustrated when professors wouldn't just tell me what they wanted. I also understand that you can't do that because it's like two different models of learning, and this idea that especially prevalent with high school and K through 12 is that students are bottles to be filled and we just pour smart into them. I like Maria Montessori, whose theory was that students are really more like candles to be lit. We want to find your passion and inspire you. And in that theory, the inquiry learning, in that theory, students can go beyond the professor. They can do things that are bigger, better. They can come with ideas that we hadn't thought of. They can go beyond the professor. They're not limited by the professor. A lot of traditional teaching, what seems to be popular among people who don't know anything about learning or teaching, it's limiting. And I think we're seeing today the consequences of not teaching people how to think and discouraging critical thought. People who don't think critically are easier to manipulate, but it's not a good thing. Good, well-constructed writing assignments are supposed to be hard to write, and professors are looking for your own self-motivated intellectual work. This really describes my approach to the class. I will note, I made an annotation here. I want the skillful use of high-quality, credible, relevant sources. This is not reference material. So, Wikipedia, there's a couple reasons I don't think Wikipedia doesn't get quoted very often after high school. In college, citing Wikipedia in a paper is like going to a fancy dress party and, well, any sort of cocktail party sort of situation with the mature adults, you know, and telling people that you pee in the shower. You know, maybe everybody does it, but it's not something you just tell people blurting out in public, okay? It's private, personal. Using the encyclopedia, any reference book, and if it says reference in the title, it's a reference book, a textbook. These are places to start your research. And if that's what you're citing on your paper, you didn't really research, you just started. Just scratched the surface. You need to learn. And it's not about answering my question. It's about figuring your own question. If you answer your question too soon, then maybe you need to reformulate your question. You're not digging deep enough. You're not learning enough. You don't learn an answer and stop in my class. You learn as much as you possibly can. You push yourself to learn as much as you can about something you care about. Figure out what you care about and make it something relevant to your education or career. This is my goal. I want to see that you've thought through a problem, you've taken time, and if you put effort into it. And I can tell when you put effort into it. Believe me, we can all tell. Yeah, this is a quote from someone else. I got a D on my first Comp 1 paper. No one in high school cared about comma splices or fragments. And suddenly, yeah, in college, that stuff won't fly.